I don't know what I did. That's a great question. We should ask CJ Nitkowski. He's joining us now. Beautiful. What a majestic, beautiful backdrop you have there, CJ. Gorgeous books and awards and booze.
All my wives. That is amazing how your setup does look exactly like Cuomo's. Didn't you do like a comp on that? That's unbelievable. Are you in the Hamptons too?
Yeah, I am in the Hamptons. I have a majestic spread in the Hamptons, and we were just like, let's go to. No, it's just downtown Toronto, and it's a 100-year-old basement. It's but I don't know. You're right. As soon as I saw Cuomo's setup, I said, boom, I got it. I got it. I know what I can do.
CJ, is this your actual home? Is this your actual home office?
Yeah, this is my home. This is where I'm spending way more time than I expected to at this time of year. But yes, this is the spot.
You have the perfect setup in Atlanta because you always post videos of your kids playing baseball in the backyard, and you can launch bombs out there, so you got room to run around.
We're grateful that we have some space here. If I say we're out in the country, real country people would laugh. If I said we're out in the country, we're kind of like caught in between of like suburbs and country. But yeah, we got some space, which is great. So we take full advantage of it. Actually, we were just hitting some golf balls out in the batting cage, my wife and I, just a little while ago. And weather's nice here right now. And I almost feel like I'm cheating. Like this whole situation, I feel like I should be more miserable than I currently am.
Right, right. Yeah, because normally you'd be on the road. CJ, you are the color man for the Texas Rangers. And normally, this is kind of unfortunate because you guys would be in the new stadium now, or yep. Is the stadium, it is done.
Globe Life Field was set to open up. We were gonna start on the road. We had a 4-game series that was planned in Seattle, and then we're going to come back and open up this new better-than-a-billion-dollar ballpark with a retractable roof, which means no more Texas heat that's just, you know, sweltering and brutal. And unfortunately, it's been put on pause.
Oh, man, that's brutal. Have you been to the new stadium?
I've been to it, yeah, but I haven't seen it since it's finished. So okay. we got to look at it well before spring training. I think I was there in February was the last time that I was there. And it seemed like they knew they were going to be on time, but they were going to be cutting it pretty close. I did get a walk through the clubhouse to try to put in perspective for people. The Yankees, for the longest time, had one of the biggest clubhouses at 20,000 square feet. This one is 40,000 square feet. I mean, and that includes everything. It's unbelievable the stuff that these guys have nowadays. And as their manager, Chris Woodward, said, of course, Blue Jays fans certainly familiar with him, said, our guys have absolutely no excuse not to be prepared now.
Amazing. Amazing. So your thoughts on the Houston Astros basically getting away scot-free now?
It almost feels like it.
Right.
It hurts a little bit. As a guy that calls games for the Rangers, you know, there was no tears that were shed when this whole thing went down. But I think they're still going to wear it. I actually talked to Steve Sparks the other day. He's a good friend of mine, does radio for the Astros. He said spring training was pretty brutal. He said they were getting it really good. So it'll be softer. I mean, of course, there has to be fans there at some point, and I have a feeling we'll probably start the season without fans. But I will tell you this, Rangers fans won't forget, Yankees fans won't forget, Dodgers fans won't forget, but it won't be nearly as bad as it was. And they even benefit not only because there's a little bit of time off, but also just from a team standpoint, like getting some of their older guys healthy, they're in a pretty good position to still be pretty good this year too once we get playing.
CJ, when all that stuff came out, you talked to a lot of people in baseball. Yep. Were a lot of people say, when the Astros sign stealing stuff came out, did they say, oh yeah, I knew that?
Yeah, I think to some degree. There was always speculation. Some guys definitely knew. And it's not a surprise. I mean, in our game, and go back, you know, decades, always trying to cheat, right? Always looking for an edge. That's nothing new to baseball. There is a line in there somewhere. They definitely crossed it. And, you know, the thing about the Astros, like, they've been a really good organization. But over the years, these past few years, they haven't been making a lot of friends outside of the Astros. Like, and they don't care. They're unapologetic about it. It's kind of the way that they've run business down in Houston. And they've been very successful. So who cares? If they want to kind of rub in your face and don't care about, you know, being a nice guys, you know, more power to you. But when something goes bad, everyone else is pretty happy to see your fall. And I think that's part of the situation that they were in. And they were just so blatant about it, too. And that's the other part of this. Like, it's one thing that everyone's always looking for an edge and trying to cheat. But the fact that you would do that right in the dugout and think that you were at some point we're not going to get caught, knowing how much turnover there is in our game, I mean, that's just ignorance. You deserve to get caught for that.
Yeah, trash cans are not subtle. I mean, there's no other way.
Really amazing.
there's no other way to put it. So for you, you know, the way you spoke earlier in this interview, CJ, I get the impression that you are convinced we will be playing baseball this year, correct?
I hope so. I really do. And I think we will. You know, I live in Atlanta. And so here in Georgia, things are they're starting to kind of loosen the reins a little bit. What's helpful is that states that are trying to open up are baseball states in Florida, in Arizona, in Texas. There's been some talk about maybe a three-city plan or a three-kind-of-area plan to open up the game. Every idea has been thrown out there, but I am encouraged by that. I'm encouraged by the NBA opening up practice facilities in states that have also loosened the reins on some of the stuff that's been going on with the coronavirus. So I'm hoping at the absolute latest, like first week in July, maybe we can get started even earlier than that. I think the guys are going to need at least 3 weeks of spring training. And depending on what plan they go with, I don't know if you guys saw that Arizona-Florida plan where essentially you go to your spring training site and we just have baseball in those two states, at least to start the year. It'd be fun because there'd be radical realignment if that's the way that we do it, and it is a way that we can get it done. It's also nice that baseball is open to playing regular season games in October and then maybe starting the postseason in November, so that'll get us an extra month. So I'm optimistic. I don't say I'm confident, but I'm optimistic that we're going to play, and it could be something around 100-game season.
Yeah, see, I said this in the last week's podcast. Of all sports, baseball's the best suited because of the length of the season. You can trim games and still have a legit season.
It'll still feel like a long season. Yeah. Probably 100 games will, you know, we'll still, if we think about that, if we only play 100 games, we'll still play more games than any other sport by a pretty good amount. So what's going to be interesting is the different ideas that the league comes up with, what they're going to try to implement. It could be a little bit experimental. It'll certainly be pushback from those that have loved the game for a long time and are traditionalists, but we may see some things that end up sticking. Some more doubleheaders. The thing about it is the players are motivated too, because they're going to be prorated on their salaries. They're not going to get their full salary, so they're going to want to play as many games as we possibly can as well, which would mean some doubleheaders and whatever else we've got to do to make it happen.
And I guess the concept, you know, we've been talking a lot about some of these other team sports, like the NBA. It's fine to say they're going to practice, but when you read the details, you know, no one's allowed to practice together. There's like four guys allowed in the training room at the same time, off the court. And then you get players playing, like they're bumping into each other. Whereas in baseball, you know, maybe it's like you just point at a guy and he's out. You know what I mean? Like maybe there's no more tagging out. Maybe it's like everyone, right? And maybe it's like 6 feet. You're able to maintain that distance. You're definitely pitcher to catcher. That's good. And all the outfielders are far apart. Everything. Like, I mean, in some ways, baseball's really suited to, you know, continuing on in this kind of situation.
I would love to see the video review for pointing a guy out.
Well, that would be a little awkward, but how about the idea of going to wiffle ball or kickball style where pegging is allowed, right? I mean, yes. That was great in grade school. You could just throw the ball at the person, and if you hit them, they're out. Maybe right. Everyone keeps like a tennis ball in their back pocket just in case you want to do that. Yeah. I don't think hitting somebody with a baseball would necessarily work, but you're right. I mean, obviously there's slides and there's some close plays here and there, and there is some contact, but nothing like any of the other sports. So I think that helps to some degree. I don't know if you saw that one idea that they threw out there about, you know, not having the home plate umpire right behind the catcher, maybe going to the automated strike zone, but then having that umpire kind of far off. I don't love that because the batter and the catcher still have to be close to each other anyway. So I think if it's that extreme, we're probably not ready to play baseball anyway. I mean, listen, who doesn't want to see, you know, Aaron Boone getting an umpire's face and spit all over him? Like, that's still part of our game. I think we kind of need it.
I like the idea of if a manager and an umpire are going to argue that there are two designated, almost like on deck
yes.
for arguing.
Yeah,
you know,
or a 6 foot pole
apart. Yeah, just like, you know, just far enough apart where they can argue at each other, and then the on deck circles can be sponsored, right? We can make some more money off of it. So
whatever it
yeah,
takes.
We should call Manfred. We should give him a call because I feel like we got some good ideas.
Going to be great calls. Oh, they're in the argument circles.
Well, listen, he is for sure the most progressive commissioner we've ever had. I mean, you see the ideas that come out of the office. He'll listen to just about anything. I know he's taken a lot of criticism, but I think he's done a really good job for our sport. But there's no conversation he won't have. So if I were you guys, I'd pitch it.
Well, let me ask you this, CJ. Did you watch the NFL draft? And what did you think of the whole format of it? Because you talk about commissioners who were not popular. Roger Goodell was as unpopular as it got. And yet I argued at the beginning of this podcast that he almost remade his image over this past weekend with his casual several costume change relaxed basement approach to this draft, which I think was very successful.
Yeah, almost as if he was a human being, right? I mean, I think that's right. Kind of like he broke that down finally. And when you make the kind of money that he makes and sits on top of a monster corporation like the NFL is, it's easy to be the punching bag, I think, for most fans. And listen, I think it goes for most commissioners. Adam Silver maybe does the best job and I think probably has the most fans behind him maybe of any sport. You guys would know better than I would. But it's kind of what happens if you're a commissioner. You sign me up for that job. It's like, hey, you're making so much money sitting on top of a huge empire. It means you're going to get booed or you're not going to be well liked. But I'm with you. I thought they did a pretty good job. It's kind of funny listening to people talk about like, oh, what's it going to be like to have to be told that you were picked by somebody over the phone? I'm like, yeah, welcome to the sport, the way sports were for the rest of us up till about, you know, 10 years ago. I have a picture of me in a pair of really tight jean shorts and a St. John's t-shirt on a huge Zach Morris cordless phone, you know, talking to Jim Bowden of the Reds, letting me know that he just picked me. Like, it wasn't that long ago that that's the way we always did things.
We should know these things. I should have an info sheet. What round did you go in?
I was a first rounder. I tricked him. Like, draft day was maybe the highlight of my career. Even though I played for 19 years, I was ninth overall in 1994.
Got
three picks ahead of Nomar Garciaparra.
Whoa!
Oh!
Take that, Nomar.
Got him.
Take that, Nomar.
Well, speaking of your career, a clip is making the rounds when you struck out Michael Jordan.
Yeah, I was fortunate. So after that draft in 94, having a very aggressive GM, Jim Bowden with the Reds sent me right to double A, which is not uncommon. You don't usually do that with your draft picks. You send them to short season, rookie ball, A ball, whatever it may be. But he put me right into double A, which just happened to be the same double A league that Michael Jordan was playing in. So I got a couple of starts against the Birmingham Barons that year. And then the clip that I just tweeted out yesterday was one that my dad just happened to be taking videotape of. And it worked out well. And he certainly didn't have a future in being a director or anything else. But he zoomed in on Jordan, and he just got lucky that right as he zoomed out and I ended up striking him out, you could see me throwing that last pitch, him swinging and missing. And he actually did a really nice job with it. But, yeah, I got to face him a couple of different times, struck him out a couple of times. And, you know, anybody that knows anything about my career is not surprised that I also walked him three times. I tell people all the time, it was the, you know, again, of those 19 years, the one moment, even though it was in my first year, my first couple of months as a professional, that I was standing on the mound going, holy crap, I'm facing Michael Jordan, the greatest basketball player that ever lived. I mean, even though it wasn't the same sport, it was amazing.
It blows my mind, CJ, and of course, like, now that The Last Dance is on, it's like we're reliving it all over again. But I remember when he retired, I remember distinctly, I remember the Sports Illustrated cover, I remember being as shocked as anyone. What I don't remember is that he was only 30 years old. That's what blows me away.
Yeah, and almost seemed like he was older at the time, right? Because when you're young, yeah. I was 21 years old. I wasn't, I basically, again, came straight from college to that. So it seemed like he was much older and he had so much that he accomplished, which I know people love to, you know, take these other sport athletes that try to play baseball like Tim Tebow and Michael Jordan and others and try to make it seem like it's a novelty or what they're doing is a huge failure. But what he did at that age, having never played professional baseball before, was pretty amazing. You know, he hit three home runs that entire year. He hit a home run in a game that I started. So I got to see one of those home runs live. It was in Birmingham. And I had three friends drive down from New York. You know, I grew up in suburban New York. And I had three buddies drive down 17 hours to Birmingham, Alabama, to watch me pitch against him. I didn't have a very good game, but they had a blast. Not surprisingly, they were hammered. And at one point, one of my buddies stands up. You know, they always had good crowds there. But he stands up and he yells, "Hey, Jordan, Scottie Pippen says you suck." And on the next pitch, he hit a homer. It was unbelievable. Yeah, I mean, just, and my poor other, like, teammates, one of my buddies who was from Alabama was like, "Hey, were those your friends that were sitting up there right behind my parents, super drunk and cursing the whole game?" I'm like, unfortunately, yes, those are my guys.
Oh, man. Sounds like Toolsy's buddies from
Peter. Well, CJ, this was a blast, buddy. We really appreciate you coming on.
My pleasure. I'm glad I didn't overdress. I wore my Doosan Bears jersey for you guys. It's a team in Korea that I played for. There's been a lot of dress-up going on around the house, man. It's strange times.
I want to go see a Korean baseball game when this all gets corrected because you said it was awesome there.
It's fun. Either one, yeah. Japan or Korea, we'll take them both. But listen, the KBO is going to start playing May 5th, so that's some good news for us as well. Chinese baseball is already playing. No fans in the stands. And I did see a really funny quote from one of the Korean players said, "The hardest part right now is not spitting." because they've asked them not to spit at all anywhere. And they're having a real challenge doing that.
Yeah, a lot of different parts of the game like that. The etiquette is going to change a little bit. That's true. I never thought about that.
Yeah, so no more spitting.
All right. Good Thanks, talking buddy. To you, my friend.
All right, see you guys. Great to see you as always.
We'll see you, CJ.
See you, CJ.